All right, good morning, Friendport family. It's another new day. It's almost the end of the week. It's Friday, the end of this working week for most of us. Welcome to our General Assembly for today. Sorry for the late start, but as usual, we're going to start with some music. It's a good morning indeed. So those persons who are just joining us, we are off to a late start this morning for our online assembly, but we will continue because you know that we are not going to start the day right. We have to start it with God. So this morning, our guest presenter is Dr. Ryan Robert Simpson. He's a proud and patriotic Jamaican. He was born in the parish of Portland and raised in the parish of St. Anne in the rural farming community of Matney. His educational preparations include a Doctor of Ministry degree with concentration in youth and young adult ministries from Andrews University in Michigan, a master's degree in family relations from Montemorelos University in Mexico, and a bachelor's degree in religion from Northern Caribbean University. Dr. Simpson is a minister of religion by training and has worked for the Seventh-day Adventist Church for over 17 years as pastor and as administrator in various capacities in Jamaica, Bermuda, and the United States of America, where he also served as chaplain of the prestigious Harvard University in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Dr. Simpson is married for 18 years, a father of three, speaks Spanish fluently, enjoys playing tennis and playing with the piano, enjoys working, serving people, and has his ultimate purpose to one day serve the Jamaican people through representational politics. It's my honor and privilege this morning to welcome Dr. Ryan Simpson to Friendport High School. Dr. Simpson, it's over to you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Principal, and thank you very much for your kind words of welcome and introduction. Good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear me. I'm hearing you very clearly, and I hope you're hearing me just the same. I am very honored and delighted to be participating in the devotional exercise this morning for the Friendport High School. Thank you so much for the invitation, and I want to say thanks to the board chair, Mrs. Thelma Jo Hill, for her gracious recommendation as well. I am not a stranger to Fern Court High School or to Claremont, as those of you who at least know a little bit of my recent past history know that I'm very connected to Fern Court High School. Mr. Principal, so I think you have handed over host to me. I'm going to have to pass it back to you because there are a number of people trying to join, and while I'm talking, I may miss it, so I'm going to pass host back over to you. Just let me do that right now. Oh, okay, you have me as co-host. Okay, that's fine. All right, that's good. So you will see them coming in as well. Well, I understand that I don't have a lot of time. So, and people who know me know I can be very long-winded. So I'm going to try to see if I can make my devotional thought this morning as concise as possible. I've always told that a good speaker is one who stands up to speak, speaks up to be heard, and then shuts up to be appreciated. So I'm going to try to see if I can, honor all three arms of that great advice. This morning, I want to share with you one of my favorite texts of scripture that is found in the Old Testament book of Joshua, Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 6, verse 1 to 3. And just a little background on this text. So the Israelites would have now spent over 40 years in the Sinai desert, in the wilderness, after having left Egypt 40 years ago on their way to Canaan. And a lot of things happened along the way. And so that journey that was supposed to have lasted only a year turned out to be a 40-year journey. All of the adults who had left Egypt now died in the wilderness, including Moses and Aaron. And so the leadership devolved upon Joshua to lead the some 1.8 million people across the River Jordan into the Promised Land. They finally got across the River Jordan, and they entered by way of this city called Jericho. Jericho would now be the gate to the Promised Land, the entrance to the Promised Land. And here's how Joshua chapter 1, verses 1, outlines the situation of the children of Israel as they come to the entrance of the Promised Land. Joshua chapter 6, 1 says, "Now Jericho was tightly shut up because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in." So that was their experience as they came to that place that God has promised them, the Promised Land, Canaan. The Bible said Jericho, which is the gateway, the entrance to their Promised Land, was tightly shut up, was locked up. In essence, you could say they were locked out of the Promised Land. There was no way in. And, you know, in ancient cities, those who know about ancient cities know that they're usually gated, high walls, massive stone walls with one way in, one way out, as it were. And in fact, if you understand the history of Jericho, the Mount of Jericho, the stone wall of Jericho is one that, you know, you'd have to be a very well prepared army, like the Romans, with battering rams and, you know, mighty armies to be able to break that wall down to get in. And so the children of Israel, who are very unprepared, coming out of a desert, no military might, no military training, come to find themselves locked out of their Promised Land. But interestingly, and you know, the essence of my devotional thought this morning, as I'm speaking to students as well as teachers, because, you know, and staff and the leadership of Fern Court High School, the challenge that we always have faced, that we always faced with, is that, we have this, all of us have this dream destination, this dream goal, this definite purpose in life, this objective, this, you know, what we want to become, what we want to achieve, what we want to accomplish. We have vision of our lives, and our visions are usually one of glory and prosperity and accomplishments and achievement and overcoming and victory and wealth and, you know, riches. We think highly of ourselves and our future. And people also, there are many people in our lives also just look at us and say, listen, you're destined for greatness. You're destined for great things. You're going to do well in life. You're going to do great. You know, we ascend to certain ranks in our lives, Mr. Principal, yourself included. You know, you're now the leader of this great organization, great institution with great history, you know, but at some point in time, you come to that point where you think it's going to be a cakewalk, a walk in the park, you know, only to find out, my goodness, this thing is hard. This thing is almost impossible. You want to quit. You want to give up. You know, every step you take, there's a stone wall. There's a mound. There's a roadblock. You know, there is something that threatens to abort the great plans you have for your life. Something that threatens to distort the visions you have, to derail you, to detour you, detract you, turn you back, to delude you, to delay you, make you disillusioned. And all of us have that experience, whether we are students, staff, teachers, leaders, we always come to that point in our lives when sometimes you sit down and wonder, am I making the right decision? Did I hear the message right? So many of us, we heard it right, not just from man, but from God. It is God who appointed us and assigned us to certain position that we're in. And you wonder sometimes, you question, God, did I hear it right? Like the children of Israel, you said Canaan was our promised land. You parted the ocean, the mighty Red Sea, to make us pass through. And you parted the River Jordan that was at flood stage, and you made 1.8 million people come through. But now we come to Jericho, the promised land entrance, and we are locked out. The Bible says Jericho was tightly shut up from without and shut up from within. No one would come out, could come out, and no one would come in. In fact, historians say that at that point in time when the Israelites came to Jericho, the people of Jericho, it was just after the harvest was taken in. So they had enough food to hold out a siege for over 3 months. The water source of Jericho runs through the city, so nobody needed to come out. So the children of Israel were literally locked out of the promised land. But I want you to look at verse 2 and verse 3 of the same text. It's, even though the Bible says Jericho was tightly shut up from without and from within, that no one could go in and no one could come out, you know, and Joshua and the children of Israel were maybe now questioning themselves and questioning God. God, you have put in front of me an impossible situation. You led me to a place in my life where there's no way out. The doors are locked up. The doors are closed. I'm going to fail. I'm destined to fail. And yet in that very moment when Jericho was locked up tightly, this is what God said to Joshua. Verse 2, the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have delivered Jericho into your hands along with its kings and its fighting men. That is very interesting. Now you come to that point in your life when everything seems impossible. You come to that point in life when everything seems gloomy and doomed. You are destined to fail, and you hear the voice of God say, look, I've given you victory. You know, that is something about God that people never understand. And we need to always understand who's directing and guiding our lives. You know, if you understand that it's God who will bring you to it, then you will understand that he also will bring you through it. You know, and that's the most important lesson that we can learn from the story of Joshua and the Israelites. If God takes you to it, he will bring you through it no matter, come hell or high water. It is God who brought the children of Israel to the Red Sea and he brought them through it. It was God who brought the children of Israel to the River Jordan and he brought them through it. And I challenge you that it doesn't matter how impossible the circumstances are, no matter what the stumbling blocks are in the way of achieving our vision, our destiny, to that accomplishment that we set out for. Every problem that present themselves sometimes as someone says, we are surrounded by enormous opportunities that often disguise themselves as unsolvable problems. That a problem can be a wonderful opportunity to experience great victory. And that is the story of Joshua and the children of Israel. They came to a problem that presented itself. Many people saw it as a problem. And it's how we view life that determines the outcome oftentimes. For Joshua and the Israelite, it was a problem, but for God, it was an opportunity, because here the doors of Jericho were locked and God said, look, I have given you the city. I have delivered to you the kings into your hands. And oftentimes I find that It is in that moment when life seems hardest that your greatest breakthrough comes. It is that moment when things seem like they're going, you know, they're falling, crumbling on the ground, that if you could just hold on a little longer, you'll see that that's a moment of your greatest opportunity. And God said to the children of Israel, I'm giving you the city. Now, one thing we need to understand, that just because we want that which God has given to us, and just because we see it, and just because we like it and we envision it, doesn't mean that it's not going to come with hard work. Because verse 3 tells Joshua and the children of Israel what's going to happen. It is yours for the taking. You're going to have it. But listen, you're going to have to work for it. And it's what God said in verse 3. March around the city once with all the men. Do it for 6 days. Have the priests carry the trumpets and ram's horns in front of the ark. On the seventh day, march around the city 7 times and blow the trumpet. And interestingly, Joshua and the Israelites complied. Now, you know, so the first lesson that we want to learn from Joshua and the Israelites is, one, oftentimes our opportunities come disguised as unsolvable, impossible problems. But that's fine. If God takes us to it, he will take us through it. Number two, our victory, the accomplishment, our visions, our goals, our destiny will come with hard work. The Israelites were able to make it to their promised land, but not after hard work. What was their hard work? They had to march for 6 days around the walls of Jericho. Actually, 7 days. They marched for 7 days around the walls of Jericho. Every day, they march once for 6 days. They wake up in the morning early, and they go and they march once, and they go back home. Sometimes what you're doing may not make sense to the average person, but if you know and believe in what you set out to do, and you know it's going to bring the result that you desire, then do it still. One of the biggest problems in life is that one of our biggest reasons cause for our failure is not that we don't believe in what we're doing, is because we listen to people who don't believe in us more than we listen to ourselves. So we make our decision based on public opinions. The Israelites were supposed to march around the walls of Jericho, and it looks like foolishness. It made no sense to them, but that's what God said. A lot of times what you're doing, Mr. Principal, what you're doing at Front Porch sometimes may not make sense to the average onlooker, to the outsider, but you know in your heart of heart what your mission is, what your destiny is, what you set out to do. And even though it doesn't make sense, you cannot afford to allow public opinion to derail that vision. You cannot afford the outsiders and the spectators. The best players in any game are usually the ones sitting on the sidelines. The best players in a football match. I went to watch Brian Lara once at the National at Sabina Park, and sitting in bleachers, not even in one of the, you know, more prime real estates of the game, but in bleachers where the cheapest tickets are, and that's where the best cricketers were. When Brian Lara missed a stroke, everybody cussed and said how much of an idiot this man is, as if they could do better. Usually, people who can do better are the ones who are on the sideline. And because you know, until they get into the game and see the real deal, you know, then that's the only time they'll understand. We cannot allow public opinion to dictate and determine how we perform. God said march. Just march. They marched 6 days. And on the seventh day, they marched 7 times. So all of 13 times before the wall come down. Therefore, my third lesson is, and I'm closing with this, ladies and gentlemen, no matter what, no matter how hard the road, no matter how long, no matter how tiring it is, if you have a vision, you have a dream, you have a destiny, young people, you will fail many times in the journey towards your destiny. I have failed. I'm standing here today. If you could just allow me to quickly tell one of my stories. As a youngster, I was always told, growing up in Matney, I was always told I would never amount to much in life. My grandmother told me that I'm going to grow up to wash my cousin's car and mow her lawn. She's going to be a lawyer and I'm good for nothing. And so for most of my journey, I grew up, I was a slow learner. I failed every exam you could think of. Common entrance, I failed that. I failed it. You name the exams, and I failed them. Secondary high school. And I remember I graduated from high school twice, by the way, because after I graduated from secondary high school, I went back to a private school, went back into 10th grade, and I remember my English teacher told me once, she, you know, I mean, well, my English teachers always tell me how, you know, how terrible I am with the English language. As a preacher, as a young preacher growing up, the first time I preached at my home church, my mother was just so embarrassed. She was, you know, so embarrassed that she sat out in the foyer for the entire duration of the sermon because I was just terrible with the English language. One morning they asked me to do devotion at school. And when I was done, my English teacher called me and she said, "Ryan, you massacred the English language. English was just the worst thing for me. I failed. My highest grade in high school for English has always been D's and F's. Highest. I failed English language for CXC 3 times. I was admitted in college on the contingency that I would have to sit an introduction to comprehension class in college. And in that introduction to comprehension class, my teacher's name was Miss Castro. And believe me, she behaved like Fidel Castro. And, you know, there were more red ink on my paper when I get them back from her than black ink or blue ink. But I realized that I needed to pass English language in order to graduate from college. I still needed CXC. And you know, it dawned on me that anything we want in life has to come with hard work. The long and short of it is that at the end of the day, finally, I went to sit my CXC. Actually, it was GC. I went to sit my GC exam. Again, after failing it 3 times and failed all of my high school English exams and anything that has English in it, I failed. Finally, I sat one more time and I got an A. How do I move from an F and a D to an A? Was one thing and one thing only. Hard work. It doesn't matter. Hard work and determination. Never give up, young people. Never give up on what your dreams are. Never give up. It doesn't matter if you're at the bottom of your class right now at Ferncourt High School. I promise you, I, who graduated at the bottom of my first high school class and entered my second high school at the bottom of the class, and even though I failed English language, I graduated at the top of my high school class. And one day I will get the chance, I'll tell you that story. There's nothing in life that we can't achieve and accomplish, but it comes with hard work. So number one, every problem, every opportunity comes oftentimes disguised as the problem that can't be solved. And you have to see the opportunity in the problem and don't let that stop you. Number two, you have to work for it. No, don't let nobody tell you that you can get rich quick and try to get you into a Ponzi scheme to put $100 in and get $10 million out. It doesn't work. You have to put the work in. The children of Israel had to march 13 times around the wall of their promised land before they got in. And number four, you just can't give up. You can't quit. Mr. Principal, I want to end with a video, if you'll allow me to just share this video, because I think it's a very powerful story of a young African runner back in 1980, one of the Olympics of the 1980s. His name is John Stephen Akwari of Tanzania. And I'm going to allow me to share my screen. I'm sorry. I think I had the wrong one. This one. Were you hearing it?
No, I wasn't hearing.
You wasn't?
Share, click, okay. Share song.
All right, let me get that. So that's sharing computer audio, correct?
Yes.
All right, so I think I've done that. Are you hearing the sound?
Yes, I'm hearing the sound.
Okay, good. All right, now I can share the screen.
At the 1968 Mexico City Marathon, three men earned the right to stand on the victory platform. The winners of the gold.
Not hearing the song.
You're not singing?
I'm singing, no, but not hearing the song.
Oh, all right. Let's see what's going on again.
At the 1968 Mexico City Marathon, three men earned the right to stand on the victory platform.
Are you hearing now?
Yes, I'm hearing.
The winners of the gold, silver, and bronze Olympic medals.
No, not seeing anything.
Oh, so I guess it seemed like we won't be able to hear or see at the same time. I'm not sure what I'm doing wrong.
You would have clicked share audio, right?
Yes, I did click share audio. So let me see what's going on here. And if not, then I'll just have to, I don't want to hold up your. Okay. So once I click share.
Then you click the video. Okay, share audio.
Right, I click share audio and then my video is on my, it's a PowerPoint it's a presentation.
Okay.
Okay, I think I see what's going on. Let's try one more time. Can you see now?
Yes, I'm seeing now, but no audio.
No audio.
Maybe you can just tell us what is happening.
Okay.
A little over an hour, three men earned the right to stand on the victory
platform. I'm hearing the audio, no.
The winners of the gold, silver, and bronze Olympic medals.
Okay, all right, I think audio is better.
The reward is a personal one. The knowledge that they finished what they set out to do. A little over an hour after the winner of the marathon crossed the finish line, John Stephen Akwari of Tanzania approaches the stadium. The last man to complete the journey. A voice calls from within to go on, and so he goes on.
Not hearing anything, no.
All right. I guess I'll have to tell you the gist of it. So the story is about a young man, John Stephen Akwari from Tanzania. John Stephen Akwari came to the 1968 Olympics in Mexico City. Don't quote me on the date. I think it's 68 or 86 in Mexico City. 1 hour after the race was done and all of the runners, came in, the winners declared first, second, third, gold, silver, bronze medals. 1 hour later, this young man came limping into the stadium, feet bandaged up, bruised, battered. He was a part of the marathon and everybody thought he had given up. He had fallen a bit at least three times along the way. 1 hour, he came, he approached the stadium, and he entered the tracks, made the final lap, and headed towards the finish line. Everybody's wondering, did this guy know that the race is over? Did he know that he doesn't need to run anymore? We've already declared the winner. Everybody was thinking that, but in his head, he needed to finish what he had started. John Stephen Aquari hopped his way to the finish line. Interestingly, the news team was still there, about to wrap up when they saw it. So the cameras caught him making his way to the finish line. ESPN went over to interview him. Interestingly, today, not many people even remember who were the winners of this marathon. Everybody remembered this young man's name, John Stephen Aquari of Tanzania. The news reporter went to him and asked, why did you just do what you just, why did you do what you just did? Why did you think you need to, 1 hour later, still come to finish the race? And his response is what I want to leave with all of us today. Those of us who feel like we have given enough to life, and life has given not given back all that we've invested in, so it's time to quit. John Stephen Aquari's response was simple. My country did not send me 5,000 miles to start the race. My country sent me 5,000 miles to finish the race. I want to challenge you today, teachers, students, Mr. Principal, everyone, that the vision that we had for our lives from the beginning was not one where we would start it. Anybody can start something. The true winners, those who will experience the greatest satisfaction and accomplishment are those who will finish what they started, no matter how long, no matter how hard, no matter how impossible the road seems, that we will not give up, we will not let up, we will not look back, we will not slow down, we will not back away, we will not be still, we will finish the race. Thank you very much. Mr. Principal, could you allow me to pray with you before?
Sure. I was just going to ask you. Ken, go ahead.
Yes. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, our great King of Kings, our Lord of Lords, our Almighty God, I want to thank you for this privilege that you've given to me this morning to share a word with the leadership, the staff, the workers, the teachers, the students, families of this great institution, Fernford High School. And thank you for the word that you've delivered to us this morning, that there are battles to fight by day and by night for God and for the right. And we cannot give up. We cannot let go. We cannot turn back. We have visions to achieve, goals to realize, dreams to come to fulfill. And Father, this morning, someone may be at home or at school or the hearing of my voice, maybe at the verge of surrendering, giving up because life is too hard and seems too impossible. Father, remind all those who are in my hearing of my voice today that the darkest hour is always before dawn. That oftentimes the road is nearer than it seems to the faltering and fading man. And oftentimes we give up when we might have captured the victor's cup. Teach us today that open our eyes so that we may see the opportunity, the great, amazing, wonderful, marvelous opportunities that are disguised as unsolvable problems. Show us, Father, help us to make our stumbling blocks stepping stones to victory. I pronounce a blessing upon the Fernford High School and upon its leadership, upon its board chairman, upon its principal and vice principals and leadership, upon its students and staff. Let no evil come nigh the school, nor anyone that has to do with the school. Father, I pray you bless in all their ways. Let Fernford continue to be the beacon of light that this has been in this community of Claremont and parish of St. Anne and its country of Jamaica. And Father, we claim your victory today and for always. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Simpson, this morning for sharing the word with us. You reminded us that we all have a vision for life, and there will always be detractors, but we must remember God that will take us through. Thank you again.
Very delighted, sir. My pleasure.
All right. So That's it for our online assembly this morning, colleagues and parents, students on the YouTube channel. I hope you have a great weekend. I will send out a poster out to your form class for you to join at 7 p.m. for a mentorship program for persons between the ages of 13 to 19. You join via Zoom. It's a good program for you. Sometime Friday evening, you don't know what to do or support, so you can just get the passcode and the ID from your form teachers. I would have sent it to them this morning for you to join the mentorship program at 7 p.m. this evening. It was a great week. We come to the end of another. You know you have your classes starting now. And you will join me again on Monday morning at the same time when I will do it all over again when we start the day right with God. Have a good day and a great weekend, and see you again on Monday.